Hello, HCPC. Behalf of the praise team, we miss you guys so much, and we can't wait to see you guys in person. And we are counting the days until we can really see each other face to face. So stay strong and keep praying and stay focused on God, and we'll see you guys soon. All right, so let's pray and we'll begin our praise. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you, Lord, for continuing to bless us, Lord. Continue to keep us safe, Lord. And Father, help us to not lead astray, Lord, to go away from you, Lord. Lord, when we feel that we are, Lord, going away from you, Lord, Lord, pull us back to you, Lord. Pull us back into your arms, and help us to stay focused on you, Lord. And Father, Lord, this today's worship, Lord, it's all about you, Lord. All this music, all these praises that we sing, Lord, it's for you. Lord, the message that we're going to hear today, Lord, it's all about you, Lord. Lord, today is all about you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for just continuing to give us blessings, Lord, and loving us. And we thank you for that. Father, just enjoy this service, Lord, and we love you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. All right, let's all rise, stand up from your chairs, stand up from your beds, and let's praise the Lord at this time. And let's please open the eyes.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord, open. Open the eyes of my heart, I want to see you.
Yes, Lord.
I want to see you.
Open the eyes.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you.
To see you high lifted up.
To see you high lifted up. Shining in the light of your glory. As we sing, holy, holy, holy.
Let's please open the eyes.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you.
Open the eyes.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. To see you,
to see her high lifted up,
to see you high lifted up, shining in the light of your glory, pour out your pearl love, as we sing holy, holy, holy,
to see you high,
see you high lifted up, shining in the light of your glory,
and pour out.
As we sing holy, holy, holy.
Let's sing holy, holy.
Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. I want to see you.
Holy, holy.
Holy, 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 Lord. Holy, 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 Lord. I want to see you.
One last time, let's be holy.
Of your glory. heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you.
One last time, open the eyes.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you.
I want to see you, Lord.
I want to see you.
I want to see you.
I want to see you.
I want to see you, Lord.
I want to see you.
One last time, I want to see you.
I want to see you. I want to see you.
Amen. Let's continue our worship, and we're going to praise, hear praises at this time, and let's put our hands together. And let's praise, may our homes be filled with dancing.
May our homes be filled with dancing. May our streets be filled with joy. May injustice bow to Jesus. As the people turn and pray.
From the mountains and to the valley.
From the mountains to the valley.
Hear our praises, Lord.
Hear my praises. Rise to you.
From the heavens.
From the heavens to the nations. Hear my singing. Fill the air.
Amen. And let's praise, may our light shine in the darkness.
May our light shine in the darkness. As we walk before the cross.
And may your glory, Lord.
May your glory fill the whole world. As the water
from the mountains.
From the mountains to the valley. Hear my praises. Rise to you.
From the heavens.
From the heavens to the nations. Hear my singing.
All right, this time, let's praise hallelujah. And let's offer our praise to the Lord.
Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praises.
From the mountains to the valley.
From the mountain to the valley.
Here we sing, Lord.
Here I sing.
Rise.
Rise to you
from the heavens.
From the heavens to the nations.
Here we sing, Lord.
Here I sing.
Amen. We're going to continue to worship and we're going to praise. I want to look into your holiness. At this time, let's ask the Lord to speak to our spirit and speak to us. And let's sing of his holiness at this time.
Into your holiness, when I gaze into your loveliness, when all things that surround become shadows in the light of you,
and when I found
the joy of reaching your heart, when my will becomes enthralled in your love,
and when all things,
when all things that surround become shadows in the light of you,
and let's praise. I worship you.
I worship you.
Second verse, and it's peace. When I found the joy,
when I found the joy of reaching your heart, when my will becomes enthralled in your love, when all things that surround become shadows.
Praise, I worship you, Lord.
I worship you. I worship you.
Lord, the reason I live.
The reason I live is to worship you.
Come on, let's lift up his name and we worship.
I worship you. I worship you.
Lord, the reason.
The reason I live is to worship you.
Father, Lord, we ask you, Lord, to take control of our lives, Lord. Lord, whenever we're going in the wrong direction, Lord, we pray, Lord, that you pull us back, Lord, pull us back to you. And Lord, help us to just really think about your name, Lord. think about you, especially during these hard times. Lord, help us to stay focused on you, Lord, and only you, Lord. Father, be with us throughout the service, Lord. Lord, may you speak through Pastor Daniel as he gives a message, Lord. Lord, help us to hear, and Lord, help us to see you, Lord, as well. And Lord, help us to open up our hearts to you, Lord. Father, be with us. We love you in Jesus' name, I pray. Amen.
Good morning, HCPC. It's very good to see you here on this Sunday morning. I think if it wasn't for these Sunday morning services, I wouldn't even know what day it is. But good news, the governor, I believe, or the mayor of Honolulu just announced that our city parks are going to be open. So that's good news. Hopefully we're trending towards the right direction and we will be able to all meet eventually back here in the flesh at church. But until now, let us continue worshiping our Lord with a few announcements, a couple of housekeeping items for us here in HCPC Living Stones. First and foremost, once again, if you're joining us online and you're watching during the premiere, go ahead and say hi to one another. Aloha, I miss you, I love you, whatever you want to say in the comments. Make sure that we still keep this vibe of community going here in our online worship. Once again, as always, if you have tithes and offerings that you'd like to offer to the Lord and to the ministry here at HCPC, go ahead and go to our website, hawaiicpc.org. In the upper right-hand corner, there should be a blue offering button you can click on. And from there, you can give your tithes and offerings. There will also be a link in the description of this video. So that'll be there for you as well. Our regular Zoom meetings for youth group and for our EM will resume or will continue this Tuesday and Friday, respectively. Go ahead and be on the lookout for those sorts of notifications. And one quick announcement, too, that's not going to be on the screen below here. We're still thinking of ways that where we can reach out to our community here in Manoa. So, Living Stones family, you might receive a phone call from me sometime this week. We have some ideas that our pastors are kicking around. So if you're available, especially, you can go ahead and give me a text. If you're willing to come out here to Manoa and whether it's drop off food items or make surgical or make PPE stuff for our community, give me a holler and we'll get back to you and make sure that we give you more directions on that. Okay, but look out on the notification for that. Our scripture reading today comes from Romans chapter 8, verses 1 through 4. Romans chapter 8, verses 1 through 4. I'm going to be reading from the New International Version. It should be on the screen so you could follow along with me. Romans chapter 8, verses 1 through 4. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death. For what the law was powerless to do, because it was weakened by the flesh, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh to be a sin offering. And so he condemned sin in the flesh, in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fully met in us, who do not live according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. This is the word of the Lord for which we give thanks. Join with me in prayer really quick. Gracious Father, as we come across this beautiful passage, this absolute diamond of a verse for us, Lord God, we pray that your Holy Spirit will use the Apostle Paul's writing to speak your truth into our hearts here this morning. Lord God, may it be a word that uplifts us. May it be a word that encourages us. May it be a word that spurns us on towards love and good deeds as you have ordained for us to do. We give you thanks always. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. All right, the sermon title for today is Holiness, Do I Even Want It? And I chose this title because I have a feeling holiness is something many of you might not want to hear about. Like if I were to speak to you about joy, you'd say, yeah, you know, I could use some joy in my life. Or if I were to speak about how to spend your money wisely, you would say, yeah, you know, I could see how that could come in handy. Or even if I was to speak about how to overcome depression, even though you may not be depressed yourself, you may say, you know what, yeah, I got somebody in my life who's depressed, and this would be very helpful. So yeah, Pastor, I'm listening. But if I come up here and tell you that today's sermon is going to be about holiness, how many of you have already checked out? You'd be like, nope, pastor, that's not what I want to hear about today. You know, I'm not going to get judged this morning. That's why I felt as if I couldn't just come up here and say, today we're going to talk about holiness. That is not going to work for you. So hence the title, Holiness, Do I Even Want It? I feel like I have to first convince you all to say yes to the question first before really getting into why it's so important. Because let's face it, there's only two types of people who get really excited, really jazzed up whenever the pastor speaks about holiness. And that only makes up about 5, if that, percent of the population. There's the kind of person who likes to hear sermons on holiness because they want someone else to get it. Right, you know what I'm saying? You know these kinds of people, the people that say, you should be hearing this sermon. Ever have someone do that to you? My mom used to do that to me all the time. She'd come to me and say, here, I recorded this sermon. You should listen to it. And I'd be like, what? I don't want to listen to something you want me to listen to. You should listen to it. Right? That's the first type. The other type of people who want to hear sermons about holiness is just pastors. And we pastors don't really care too much about them sometimes either, right? That's it, two types of people who get jazzed about sermons about holiness. The reason why I think this is so is because on the surface, holiness seems like it's gonna be a rebuke. It's gonna be me sitting up here for 30 minutes, you know, digging into you, making you feel guilty for all your past wrongs, you know, how unholy you all are. So yes, I agree, I get it. Nobody wants that. Nobody wants to go to the principal's office on Sunday morning. But here's where our Reformed tradition really shines. That's what we are. We're a PCA church, Presbyterian church in America. And for the most part, I really don't like to toot our denomination's horn when I'm up here, because I believe that all churches, if we're seeking to glorify Christ, glorify God together, we're all trying to love God and love our neighbor, then that's it, right? But in this instance, when we're talking about holiness, here's where the Reformed understanding of biblical interpretation really gets to shine. From a Reformed understanding, when we break it all down at its basis, being Reformed means you think less about yourself, you make it less about what you have done and what you've brought to the table, and we try our best to make it all about God and what God has done for us on our behalf and what God brings to the table. And when we look at what God brings to the table when it comes to holiness, it changes everything. It makes us actually want holiness. It makes us proud to be holy people. I know that sounds a little self-righteous to say, but stay with me or check this out. Listen, because when you hear what holiness means, you want it too. Let me give you an example. Think back with me all to when you were like in the 4th grade. I know for some of you, you may have to think way back, right? But think back to when you were in the 4th grade. When school was still fun, when teachers had a huge impact on shaping who you are and your self-confidence. Remember how cool it felt when the teacher gave you a leadership role and not anybody else? Like when the teacher made you in charge of writing stuff on the board, on the chalkboard back then. come on up here, so-and-so, and you know, dictate for me on the board. Remember that? You got all excited. You paid extra attention to the teacher. You made sure that when you wrote in cursive, by the way, back then, I don't think they teach cursive anymore, but you know, you made sure your cursive was extra spot on. You felt this way because your teacher picked you for a very special role. You were chosen from out of all your classmates. And that was such a cool feeling, wasn't it? Well, that's what holiness means. When you choose holiness, when you choose to live a holy life, it means you understand that you were picked for a special purpose. You are set aside as special for a very unique role. So before I lose some of you, because I know some of us have very short attention spans these days, if you can only remember one thing from this sermon, remember what I'm about to tell you next. Go ahead and write it down, put it on a note, send an email to yourself. Youth kids, if you can, go ahead and text this back to me to let me know that you're still listening. Here's what it is. One thing to remember. Holiness doesn't mean sinless. It means set apart. Holiness doesn't mean sinless, it means set apart. Holiness is not about living a sinless life. Holiness is about living a set apart life. See, oftentimes we let the sin get the best of us. Maybe we go out, maybe we party a little too much, maybe we make some mistakes, maybe we give in to the lust of the flesh, or maybe we even think, oh man, this week I didn't read my Bible that much, I've sinned, holy crap, you know, I'm not living a very holy life. But that's not holiness at all. Living a holy life is about knowing, believing, trusting, no matter what you've done, you are always set apart for a special purpose by God. And you are His. You had a bad week. You messed up a bit. You looked at things or done things or said things that you shouldn't have. You know what? Fine. Repent. And then move on. Right? Don't let it grab hold of you and bring you down. It's not sinless. It's set apart. It's not about conduct. It's about confidence in what God has done for you. It's not what you bring to the table. It's what God has already brought. You guys seen that movie, Bring It On? That's an old movie too. I mean, this is like old school day for us today, but Bring It On, right? You better bring it. Oh, it has already been brought. Shoot, I don't know why I did that. Maybe we should edit that out. Livingstone's family, I want to spend the rest of our time here encouraging you today to lean into this kind of lifestyle, this knowing that you are set apart lifestyle when it comes to holiness. And I want to quickly show you three ways that we as a church, we as Livingstone's ministry, wants to empower you to live a life of holiness. There are three ways that we as a church should be helping you live a holy life. And those three ways are socially, liturgically. Now, I know liturgically, we're going to get into the definition of that a little bit later, but liturgically, and then finally, with your identity. Socially, liturgically, and with your identity. So let's go over the first one, socially. We are called living stones because of 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 5, where Peter says that the church is made up of living stones who are being built into a spiritual house. Just as I pointed out back then, and I'll point out again, Peter could have used any metaphor he wanted when comparing us to a church. He could have chosen any example he wanted to when he wanted to talk about how parts make up a whole. He could have said we are all trees being made into a greater forest. He could have said we are all pieces of the same pie. He could have chosen any metaphor, but why living stones being made into a spiritual house? Because when stones are placed into a building, each stone is interdependent to the stones below them and to the stones above them. And we are being built into something, which in this case is a spiritual house. That's our purpose for why we meet, why we are brought together. We rely on each other knowing that our cornerstone, the most important stone of the building, the one that sets the entire building, is Christ. Now, socially, when people come to church, they should be able to distinguish that about us. That's what makes us as a group unique. Not our ethnicity, not our income bracket, nothing else but Christ. That's what sets us apart. People should be able to come in and look at us and see that, right? I got an example for you. Let me show you this next picture. Hopefully, we are able to get this picture to work. Give me a thumbs up if the picture's up. All right, cool. So this is a picture. You can't see it for the praise team, but everyone else can see it. It's a picture of the Harvard University marching band. This was taken a long time ago, but I happen to really love this picture. And I want you to focus on the center guy. He's the guy going like, oh, you can't see me because you see the picture. But he's the guy with his hands up, and he's very enthusiastic. what I really love about the picture is the comparison to the everyone else around the band. Look at their faces compared to the faces of those in the band. Everything about this picture shows us how the band is set apart from the rest of the audience. The band is united, they are distinct. They are all there for one purpose, and that's to be the Harvard band and to represent their school and their music. When we start meeting face to face again, I hope that something you notice about our church, when you look around, our interdependence to each other as living stones, and our unity in our purpose to glorify Christ. May our spiritual house be built into something solid instead of looking like the end of a game of Jenga. That's our first encouragement. Our second encouragement is the liturgy. Our second encouragement to holiness is our liturgy. Here, let me bring up a scenario, because I know some of you may not be familiar with this word, but this scenario will help us get to the understanding of what liturgy means. I want you all to picture in your minds, I know it's kind of hard right now because you're doing stay-at-home schoolwork, but picture in your minds that you have a big test coming up tomorrow. What do you do to study for this big test? I remember if you're like me and you had an all-nighter and you knew that you were going to stay up all night, you had to do some things first to prepare yourself. Number one, you had to go to the store, right? Get some snacks and refreshments, some gummy bears, a bag of Flaming Hot Cheetos, a couple of Red Bulls. You had to stock up on the snacks. Then when you get home, I know some of you have to clean your room, do the dishes, vacuum. You want a nice, clean environment with a solid, clean desk. Then some of you might have to change into your favorite pair of sweats. Take out your contacts, put on your glasses, put your hair in a ponytail, whatever, right? Then after all that, you get your laptop open, take out all your notes, arrange your highlighters, arrange everything on your desk just so. Then and only then can you begin studying, right? Some of you are, I'm taking you back to your college days. Right? That's your all-nighter ritual. That's your study liturgy. In short, liturgy means the rituals that we do here at church. There are rituals that we do every single Sunday as we come to church, mainly, especially when we talk about our order of worship, right? Our rituals are put in place to enhance what we believe and who we are as a church. I know some of you guys think, man, why can't churches just go ahead and just love God and sing and hear the message and that's it? But that's still a liturgy right there. Right. We have in our liturgy, just for an example, a formal greeting time when I ask one another, when you guys to ask one another to say hi to one another in the name of Christ. That's not just there so the praise team has time to transition to the floor. That is there in the liturgy as a ritual for a purpose. It's a reminder of our holiness, our set apartness. When we greet each other, we're not simply saying hi to one another. When it's actually part of the service, when we greet one another in the name of Christ, we are actually saying, yes, my brother or my sister in Christ, I'm glad that you are here. I need you the same way you need me. We're all in this together. We love God, right? There's a Julia Michaels song that, I know I'm kind of late to the party, but it's a good song. It's been in my head the past couple weeks, but it says, issues, right? You got issues. I got them too. I don't know what's going on. I'm going to, anyways, yeah, you got issues, I got them too. That's what we're saying to one another when we're greeting each other. You got issues, I got issues, but we're here because our biggest issue is how bad we need God. As corny as that sounds, that's true. When we greet each other, and I know it's really brief, many of us don't even think about it, but that's what it's there for. That's the liturgy. We encourage, we highlight the set apartness that we all share together in our liturgy. And keep in mind, the ritual is just there to highlight. It's not there to replace. There's no power in the liturgy itself, only what the liturgy represents. That's liturgy, and we want to help you live holy through that liturgy. The third way Living Stones wants to help you understand your set apartness is through a continual reminding of your identity. Romans chapter 8, 1-2 is perhaps one of the greatest passages in all the New Testament, and is definitely the peak of Paul's letter to the churches in Rome. Romans has 16 chapters, this is Romans chapter 8, it's right there in the middle. So allow me to read it again, follow along with me. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death. Hallelujah. This is saying exactly what I said was the most important thing to remember from this sermon, that our holiness, is not living a sinless life. It's living a set-apart life. You are not condemned. Instead, you are set free to live according to the Spirit of God. You are not condemned. I'm going to focus on that just a little bit here this morning, because I feel like some of you listening today may feel as if God has condemned you. Maybe it's because of some of the circumstances in your life. Maybe it's because something bad happened in your childhood. Maybe it's something you were born with. And you feel like you are living a condemned life. But that's not true at all. Let Paul's words for you today be a call, a siren for a hope of truth. Because God has not condemned you, and God has not cursed you. Paul is telling us here that if you believe in Christ, there is no condemnation. No exceptions. Nothing from the past, nothing from your upbringing, nothing from the circumstances from which you were born. And because of Christ, you have been chosen for a very special purpose. Saints, do we believe this? Chances are, take it a step further, it's because of those things that you thought disqualified you, that you thought you might be condemned, that God has chosen you for a special purpose. Let's think about that. The things that you might have thought that disqualified you, God will use that for your special purpose. There is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Tim Keller says this should be a very behold moment for you. Let me explain what he means by a behold moment. In Isaiah and later on in Matthew, all throughout the New Testament, Old Testament actually, God tells his people, behold, right? In Matthew and Isaiah, behold, this is my son with whom I am well pleased. God is asking people to behold in his son. There's an awe, there's an OMG moment here. You are shocked, you're delighted, it's unexpected, and in the end, because of it, you are humbled and grateful. That's what behold means. And Romans 8 should be a behold moment for us. I want you to think of it this way. And here's the difference between a behold moment and not a behold moment. When you work, you get a paycheck, don't you? Right? For the work that you've already done. That's not a behold moment. Why? Because you've earned that paycheck. You don't get a paycheck. Well, back when you used to get paper paychecks and not a direct deposit, you don't get a paycheck and say, behold, hallelujah, what is this? You get a paycheck and you say, yeah, that's my hard work right there. I earned it. You don't say behold in your heart from getting something you think you've already earned. But you do get a behold from something you know that you didn't deserve, but got anyways. You get a behold from therefore there is now no condemnation in Christ. You are shocked, you are delighted, it's unexpected, and in the end you are left humbled and grateful. And here's where it gets even better, because God helps you to remember this. God gives us his Spirit to keep reminding us. Look with me at Romans chapter 8 verse 4. It'll be on the screen right in front of you. The righteous requirement of the law might be fully met in us who do not live according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit of God. I know there's a lot of mystery behind the Holy Spirit and what the Spirit does, so let me clear some of it up. John Calvin says the main role of the Holy Spirit is that the Spirit binds us to the work of Christ. It binds us to the work of Jesus Christ. The Holy Spirit keeps us connected to Christ. He reminds us that we are not condemned no matter how we may be feeling at the moment. Even though we may have lived horrible lives in the past, even though we may keep struggling with the same kind of sin over and over and over again, the Holy Spirit tells us in these times and in all times, hey, remember what Christ has done. Not only has he died for you, but he has also brought you righteousness. There is no condemnation for the righteous. You are saints. So be holy, set apart, and know your worth. The Holy Spirit reminds me of that time and time again. This is holiness. Not only does God set us apart, God keeps us holy all throughout the entire week. No matter what. That's what he brings to the table. And, you know, as I close, I got a confession to make. I actually lied to you, right? I'll confess it. In the beginning of the sermon, I said there are only two people who get jazzed out to hear a sermon about holiness. The judgy, you should hear this sermon kind of person, and pastors. Well, I lied, right? There's actually three. The third person who loves hearing sermons about holiness is the person who knows that his or her holiness comes because they have had that behold moment already with God. They know what their life looks like without God. They know what their life looks like now with God. And they have beheld the glory of God. Like, wow, God, you did that for me. God, you want me that bad. You love me that much. You have set me aside for a special purpose so much that you let your son go through all of that. Behold. That's our identity, y'all. You know, Christians, we're not perfect people. Not in the least bit. But we believe we are saints because of what God has done for us. God brings all of this to the table for us. We have beheld his glory. And holiness is not sinless. It's set apart, bought at the highest price possible. Do we want holiness, Livingstones? Absolutely. The Spirit of God be with you all this week, reminding you of your holy nature until we meet again. Saints, let us pray. Gracious Father, where we are right now in our rooms or in our living rooms or in front of our computers, we pray, Lord God, that your Holy Spirit will remind us, continue to whisper into our hearts that we are saints, that we have been set apart. We pray, Lord God, that the voices in our heads will be drowned out by your still small voice and reassure us, Lord God, of your presence, of your absolute love for us. And remind us, Lord God, that we have beheld your glory in our lives. May we cling to these moments, Lord God, as we go on through the week. And all the more as we see the day approaching. We give you thanks always, always grateful, always humbled before you. And in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Amen. As we close for service, let's worship. When I look into your holiness. When I look,
when I look into your holiness, when I gaze into your loveliness, when all things that surround me become shadows in the light of you,
and when I found.
Found the joy of reaching your heart when my will becomes enthralled in your love, when all things that surround become shadows in the light of you.
And this peace, I worship you.
I worship you.
I love that song. That's a hashtag TBT song right there. Brought me back to my braces days. Teacher Wajan, can we get some jars of clay next week? Jars of clay.
Yes.
Man, I love it. All right, brothers and sisters, HCPC, Living Stones, Youth Group, and EM, receive now a blessing from the Lord. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, whose gift of grace we worship, the love of God the Father, whose holiness gives us our identity, and the reminding power of the Holy Spirit, who binds us to the work of Christ, be with you both now and forevermore. Amen. Go in peace, everybody.